Well, thanks very much, Vito. Thank you for the invitation to participate in this seminar series. And thank you to all of you for attending it. I know Zoom fatigue is a very real thing, so I'm grateful that you take this extra hour to listen to some of my thoughts. I really hope that this will be more, I mean, what I'm talking about today is not by any means a definite argument or a fully worked out idea, but really I hope the basis for a conversation. I thought what I would talk to you about is bringing the ocean into our histories of international law. My paper borrows from the title of a sort of short, very short survey piece that I have forthcoming in the Journal of the History of International Law. That piece is titled, as is this presentation, Decolonization and International Law, Putting the Ocean on the Map. And so I'd like to begin with showing you two maps from the UN webpage of decolonization. So let's see how to move this. Forgive me, I think I'm having some trouble. Oh yes, okay, I worked out. Yes, so this is the first map. This is the UN shows us the world as it looked in 1945. And it contrasts this with this other map of the world today. If you look at the two maps together, what has changed? According to these maps, there have been many changes. All on land. Empires or remnants of empires in the form of non-self-governing territories and the like have given way to states. The world today, therefore, unlike the world in 1945, is represented by the universalization of the state form. And so the images are visually dramatic as long as you confine your eyes to the land itself, to continents and what is happening on them. But look at the rest of the picture, the sea. What happens there? According to these maps, nothing. The sea remains unchanged. It was parchment yellow in 1945. It's parchment yellow today. It is as if all political change has stopped at the coast. Now, this featureless ocean is not an aberration. It is, in fact, you can see it reproduced in a variety of maps. Here, for example, is a standard map, the map that you find in the National Geographic. Again, showing a featureful world, politically demarcated world of states, but with a featureless ocean. Historians of map making will tell us that the absence of feature in the sea is not accidental. It is an omission, but it's a deliberate omission. It is in fact an artifact of a map making practice that emerged in the 17th century to replace older ways of drawing the sea. To quote historian of science Helen Rozwadowski, in those older maps, those pre-17th century maps, the sea was depicted as a thoroughly three-dimensional space, full of life and activity, textured surfaces, identifiable marine creatures, or exotic and forbidding monsters, and ships busily prosecuting maritime work. An example of this is the famous Gata Marina that is a Nordic map. It was created by Olaus Magnus in 1539, and you see in this map a contrast to the kind of National Geographic map I showed you a minute ago. You see an ocean that is crowded, textured, it's full of creatures, it's full of ships. This is an ocean that shows engagement, both actual and imaginative, of humans with the sea. This way of showing the sea, putting on page both what was known and what was unknown, began to vanish as human engagement with the sea increased. So from the 17th century on, the sea began to be drawn in ways that depicted it as a known and featureless whole. This was the mare liberum of the Grotian imaginary. We know from the work of Grotian scholars like Martin van Ittersen, David Armitage, and others that mare liberum was written in a specific context. It facilitated Dutch claims of access to and commerce with the East Indies over Portuguese claims of exclusivity. A flat, featureless whole was the basis for Grotius's argument that the sea cannot be distinguished. That is, it cannot be divided. It remains a whole, a commons, a thoroughfare that anyone can sail on, and a resource of fish. The sea in these depictions vanishes into its uses. It is not in itself a place or set of places. Of course, we know this depiction of the sea was a political depiction, and it was maintained against contemporary claims of for example, of John Selden or William Wellwood, who tried to distinguish the near seas. It was also maintained against other kinds of understandings of and encounters with the ocean, some of which Grotius would not have known about. This is, of course, a picture of the Santa Catarina, and here is as an alternative imaginary of the sea that actually existed at the time the Mare Librum was being propounded. But of course, the two imaginaries didn't really come into conversation at all until much later. So Polynesian understandings of the ocean, but also the Mare Librum idea denied or ignored the ways in which encounters that were brokered by the West's own imperialism created different understandings of the ocean. Isabel Hoffmeyer presses this point. She talks about how the myth of the empty sea is largely a product of European imperialisms and of map-making traditions in which the sea is made into a blank space across which power can be projected. And yet, and this is much like in the familiar myths of empty land, which, because they are seen as uninhabited, are made ready for taking. And like those myths of imperial of empty land, the view of the sea as well conceals traces of imperialism. What you don't see in these flat projections of an empty sea are the graves of thousands of drowned slaves. You don't see undersea cables. You don't see oil rigs. You don't see islands of plastic particles. Or traces of the millions of shipwrecks that litter the ocean floor. The sea, projected as a surface in the Grotian imaginary, would not have been a surface for those who crossed on it, or would not have been just a surface for those who crossed on it on slave ships. They would have felt the sea, every twist of the wind, every heave of the current on their bodies. The sea would have been the place where many died, and the place that their survivors would hold in mind as grave sites of their dear ones. So for many, the sea was a place. It was a place with very heightened geographical and physical specificities, even if that is not projected on maps of the sea. The blank sea, therefore, is an imperial myth. It hides from view not only the tragedy of enslaved deaths, but also many other things. The expanding appropriation of the sea's resources, the actual corridors of de facto control that Lauren Benton, for example, has talked about, the particularistic associations and world making, for example, the Polynesian ideas of the ocean as essentially of their islands as a sea of islands, the ocean as very much a part of what they could consider the world that they live and farm and cultivate. So it's this imaginary of the featureless, the blank ocean, is one that deserves to be deconstructed at different points in time. My paper is about the era of decolonization and the era where particularly imperial myths of various tribes came under robust contestation. And we know that in this period, rapid legal transformation was effected not just on land, but also on the sea. We as scholars who work on the law of the sea know that other maps would be more true to life. This is an example. This is a map that actually shows you political change on the sea. Here you see zones of national jurisdiction extended over the ocean. This is a process we know that begins with a claim in 1945 in the form of the Truman Proclamation, culminates in some respects in 1982 with the UN Convention on the Law of the Sea, which records an agreed division of the sea into a variety of legal zones. The same map you can see in its specific exposure here. Again, you see in this a sea that is now differentiated into not just one or two, but many zones. And we know that the divisions carry on. If jurisdictional lines were etched beyond the coast, dividing zones of national jurisdiction from zones of international zones, then further additional lines were etched in the period between 1945 and 1982, and in the period since, in areas also beyond national jurisdiction. So here are some further maps that we might show. This is a map of areas that are under contracts of exploitation on the deep seabed. These are contracts that have been given by the International Seabed Authority to a variety of mining corporations and states. Here is a map of fisheries and of fisheries, areas of fisheries regulation. So you see here zones that are within the jurisdiction of various regional fisheries management organizations. You also see some marine protected areas. And here is a map that brings all of the other maps that I've shown you so far together. You see then in this map a major contrast with the National Geographic map that I showed you a while ago. There you had an empty featureless ocean, no political lines on the no legal lines, no political lines on the sea. Here you see not only many political lines, but also lines crisscrossing, fighting for space, creating contradictions, something that is, again, people who work on the law of the sea, we're aware of. We never find them, however, in the maps that we might see in more general publications. And we know that even these maps could be, we know that yet more could be added to these maps. Here, for example, is another piece of detail that maps should have. This is a map of submarine cables. This shows us the various routes that submarine cables that crisscross the Atlantic, the Pacific, the Indian, various oceans of the world take. This is another map. This is a map of shipping routes, and perhaps this would be the better map because it gives us an account of the density of shipping. It gives us really a more fleshed out understanding of the ways in which various ships make lines across the sea, creating corridors of de facto control as they go. Then here is another map that we should probably superimpose on all of the other maps that we've seen so far. This is a map of the claims that plastic now makes to the sea. Each of the little white dots that you see represents 20 kilograms of plastic. So some areas where you see a density of white, you can imagine, you can see why it gives rise to this understanding of trash islands as taking over ocean space. In short, again, to reiterate the point I made earlier, we have in these maps that focus on the ocean a representation of a crowded ocean, vastly different from the blank unified space that I showed you at the start. Here's the claim. I suggest in the paper that the making and shaping of these lines offers us an extraordinary opportunity to examine both the history of international law, and not just the history of the law of the sea, and the history of decolonization. And yet, the ocean tends to be overlooked in both these broader histories. So we know that the history of international law has been burgeoning, and we've read excellent work now across a range of topics: statehood and territory, race and empire, trade and food, politics and economics, the new international economic order, the Cold War, the emergence of new legal forms and institutions. The law of the sea tends not to play a significant role in most of these accounts, and yet it provides a rich vantage point to examine and sometimes complicate these other histories. The history of decolonization, again, is a growing field, and we've seen it tackled in a variety of ways. So here you have an example of three different kinds of international histories. At the moment, there's the political economy perspective, which puts oil at the center of the story, that's carbon democracy. There's the perspective that sort of focuses on ideas and institutions of governance. That's the Mazawa book. And then you have for the Westad book, which looks at decolonization as part of this broader story of the tussle between two major world systems, capitalism and communism. The ocean is again a relevant site for all of these different histories. And yet, if you look at these books, it remains marginal to the stories. I think there may be one or two references in each of these books to the sea, and mostly just confined to discussions of navies and naval actions. The materialities of the ocean, the fact that, for example, when it comes to oil production and distribution, that 1/3 of the world's oil is found on the seabeds, so beyond national, beyond coasts. The fact that the Cold War was fought as much on the sea through espionage, through submarine cables, through a variety of activities. The fact that when it came to ideas and institutions, the Law of the Sea conferences and the Law of the Sea institutions were some of the major experiments with world governance. These are things that don't find themselves nearly as much on the page. It is, of course, not that there is no literature on the Law of the Sea. On the contrary, we know that it is a major subfield of international law, and there has been a lot that is very well written about the developments since 1945. There has been a lot to write about. We've seen, if you adjust a rough count, since 1940, just between 1945 and 1982, we can count 51 multilateral treaties, including, of course, the UN Convention on the Law of the Sea, several new legal institutions, the establishment of a dedicated tribunal for the law of the sea, a variety of regional and bilateral arrangements, and a host of soft law. And the period since 1982 has only seen an expansion, if anything, in when it comes to the production of legal documents on the sea. And the maps don't show this, but the literature does cover this in great detail and really at and sort of at extraordinary depth. Yet, I hope we can agree that most of this literature is in the doctrinal vein. It's dedicated to the exposition of the developments. It's dedicated to the explanation of the rules and how they might fit together. The theorization of these rules to go with Vito's idea for this seminar and in the historicization of the rules remain somewhat marginal. There is indeed some thought given to the politics of the law of the sea. So we do hear, when we hear about the development of the UN Convention on the Law of the Sea, for example, about the North and North-South battle, the battle between developed states and developing states, but deeper issues, the question of political economy, for example, or richer contextualizations of the ideas, of the epochs, of the developments that bring us to the present, these remain largely lacking. We might find them, and this is the other thing, we might occasionally find with excellent work being done within the pages of books that are about the law of the sea or that operate within the subfield, but then the uptake in broader accounts of the history of international law is almost nil. And I suppose the thing that exemplifies this more than anything is that if you look at handbooks that are on the international law theory or international law history, you won't either find the ocean discussed at all, or just as one chapter separated from the other chapters, and it won't sort of make its way into other discussions. So the ocean, surprisingly, remains marginal, a neglected topic. It remains neglected in historicization, and it remains a neglected topic for history writing. So the existence of the gap has been recently summed up very well by Reni Samavani in her book, where she talks about how even in global and transnational oceanic histories, the ocean itself tends to operate as an exceptional site, a site that is either focused upon only on its own terms or ignored in favor of shipping histories or navigation histories. Why should the gap, if there is a gap, and if we can agree that there is a gap, why should it be filled? It's never a good argument to just point to a gap and say, well, someone should write something about this because it's not been written about. There has to be a more positive case for filling it. And here, I think what I'd like to suggest is that examining the law of the sea can really take us into the crosshairs, or if you prefer nautical metaphors, into the currents and countercurrents of decolonization in a variety of respects. The law of the sea offers insights into the multiple possibilities that the decolonization movement held, possibilities beyond the obvious divides that have come to characterize it retrospectively. The ripples that the law of the sea, we can see through the law of the sea, the ripples of decolonization before the sort of water smoothed over and we came to this one unifying account. That brings us to statements of an international order marked by the end of history, as some have characterized it, or marked as by a sort of inevitable collapse into neoliberalism, as others have characterized it, or in the various other registers in which people have spoken, essentially of a sort of memory of a trajectory in which we had about 20 years of contestation between the North and the South, and then the sort of the coming together into one single unifying imaginary without significant ideological contestation of a sort of unified international legal order. Sorry, I'm getting slightly confused there in my enthusiasm, but essentially I think we'll see if we read most histories of the sort of mid-20th century to the end of the 20th century, essentially a familiar trajectory. We'll see that this battle for decolonization and then the smoothing over of that battle with a return to a some kind of universal. So some idea, some people characterize as neoliberalism, others would characterize as the victory of capitalism, yet others would characterize as simply the political victory of the United States, this sort of movement back to one world from multiple worlds. Well, decolonization, seen through the eyes of the law of the sea, would present us with a much more complicated picture. Not only would we get a more complicated picture of the contestations itself, they were not just between the North and South, but they operated across multiple registers and in many respects, we might also be forced to revise some of our ideas of this sort of smoothening over that seems to have happened in much of the literature in the 1990s. So we don't just emerge into a single unified Hebrew world. Through the law of the sea, we actually see the multiple worlds that remained in operation in the 1990s and beyond. Let me just illustrate what I have been trying to say with three examples of the things that we might see if we turn to the law of the sea. One is that we might see alternative political geographies in formation and in action all the way through. A second, we might see alternatives that operated to or within given extractive imaginaries of the sea. And three, we might see something of the rich flavor, the rich texture of the epistemic contestation over international law that has characterized its development since the mid-20th century. So let's look at the first, with the alternative political geographies. Now we know that from recent work, like Idam Getachew's World Making After Empire, that decolonization was not just a simple transition from empires to states. In fact, it was a much more complex process, which included also much experimentation. Idam Getachew, for example, traces the working out of a range of political forms, not just the emergence of colonies into states, but those colonies' experimentations with ideas of confederation, for example, bringing us a rich account of how it is that the state form comes to be universalized and how common protocols develop for demarcating and bounding state territory. Others have told us about decolonization also as a time of coalescence, the time when far-flung peoples and countries came together to form various kinds of alliances. It was a moment of the emergence of southern alliances like the G77 or the Non-Aligned Movement. It was also the era of the emergence of East and West alliances, the NATO and CETO and CENTO, the Warsaw Pact, the two blocs, and so forth. If all of this is now historicized in terrestrial political histories, it is worth thinking about the ways in which the ocean complicated both. For state formation, the ocean offered a virtual blank canvas. Unlike for land, where imperial lines provided an indication of where the jurisdictional claims of various peoples would end, the sea offered no precedence. The sweeps of water and seabed that would mark the seaward extents of states would be entirely down to acts of imagination. It was up to states to imagine where the seaward boundaries would lie. This was building on no precedent. Arguments with respect to how parts of the ocean could be claimed and brought within national jurisdiction were largely developed post-45. The accumulation of scattered islands into archipelagic states again was an act of imagination. The decision of some scattered islands not to become archipelagic states was again part of this imaginary. Decolonization was this rich moment of really thinking about the basis on which you would decide. Your land boundaries were in some ways given because they were imperial boundaries. The sea boundaries were dependent entirely on political assertion and political imagination. Similarly, think about alliance formation. We know that the histories of the land describe a bunch of southern alliances, they describe a bunch of eastern bloc alliances, a bunch of western bloc alliances. The sea often subverted these associated political geographies. The best account of this is offered by a journalist, William Burton Baker, who went to the UN Law of the Sea conferences in the 1980s and then wrote in the 1970s and 80s, and then wrote in 1983 a lovely long essay in the New Yorker, where he said that half the pleasure of the conference was really watching every single political alliance that had come that states had sort of brought the conference flounder under the weight of the physical and geographical realities of the sea. So here are some of the new things that cropped up. The Soviet Union and South Korea suddenly found themselves in agreement over the matter of fishing of foreign hosts. Israel and Iraq, sworn enemies, but because they were neighbors, found themselves at one on the question of passage through the straits. So every Arab attempt that was made at a formula that would to exclude Israel from the Straits of Tehran could also, Iraq found, could also be applied to itself, and therefore found itself opposing it. So they ended up, these two countries that were otherwise not, they didn't even at this point recognize each other politically, ended up having to act together. Castro's Cuba, which exported nickel ore, and Chile. So Cuba, which was massively a left-wing country, Chile, which was massively a right-wing dictatorship that exported copper, ended up taking identical positions on production limits to seabed mining. Britain and Iceland became embroiled in the Cold Wars, allies in other respects. The United States and the Soviet Union, in the middle of the Cold War, found themselves in agreement over the freedom of navigation, which they were both making a case for because of the Cold War. Fiji and Indonesia made common cause on the concept of archipelagic waters, but their definitions ended up excluding the claims of their otherwise allies, Kiribati and Tuvalu. 53 states that had almost nothing in common outside of the sea context came together to form into the group of landlocked and geographically disadvantaged states, opposing extensive claims of national jurisdiction by coastal states. And I could go on. Burton Baker goes on, and I could go on giving you lists of other examples. The interesting thing here is what it shows about the ways in which various East-West, North-South, and regional geopolitical calculations were upset by the sea. The law of the sea offers a wonderful window into the forging, the fragility, and even then the resilience of various political geographies. The fact that the South, global South, remained a distinctive political geography really comes is thrown into very sharp relief when you see how many divisions existed within the South over the question of the access to and use of the sea. So political geographies is one thing that we might throw a richer light on through the law of the sea. Secondly, in terms of decolonization's potentialities, the law of the sea also offers insight into the epistemic openness of the moment, not just political geographies that were up for grabs, but also protocols of international ordering, of how international law was to be made, was up for contestation. We see this in the trajectory of the Law of the Sea conferences, from the first conference that was based on the idea of codification to the third conference that became about, that essentially conceded to the idea of a political bargain. But more importantly, across both conferences, there were many occasions when the spotlight was cast on second order questions. What should international law be? Should it show fidelity to doctrine, or should it embrace progressive development? Should the law of the sea and its making rest on legal expertise, or should it be a matter of political decision? Should it be made by states and therefore be confined to the acts of state representatives, or does the law of the sea bring into the picture a whole range of non-state actors, including religious organizations and civil society organizations and the like? What should be the rationale? Should there be efficiency and efficient use of the sea's resources? Or should the driving force, the driving logic be equity and equitable distribution? And again, I could go on. There has been some work done on epistemic contestation in the moment of decolonization, for example, by Anthony Angi and B.S. Chimney, who have talked about how developing states tried to increase the normative weight that would be placed on General Assembly resolutions against sort of the more accepted hard sources of international law. But a whole bunch of other things, these questions of who would make the law, how it would be made, and on what logics, were made particularly manifest in the context, which was, we know, the laboratory of many unique ideas, for example, the principle of the common heritage of mankind. How and on what grounds the sea was to be made legible, made known in the law, was an open question. And this again remains an underexplored site when we look at histories of the epistemic contestation over international law in the 20th century. And again, just to press the point, we know the specificity of the Third UN Conference on the Law of the Sea, which was in some ways the grandest lawmaking, international lawmaking exercise that we have seen in so-called chartered era. Finally, as a third thing, contestations over the law of the sea reveal a rich world of alternative possibilities within, usually within, a broadly framed extractive imaginary. By an extractive imaginary, I refer to this view of the sea as resources to be appropriated by the use of industrial methods and for with commercial considerations somewhere in the picture. This, I would suggest, and this is what the argument that Isabel Feichner and I have made in the symposium that we edited in Egypt last year, this has been broadly the driving rationale of all lawmaking relating to the sea. But what we try to acknowledge in that symposium, and what we should acknowledge, is that there are many possibilities within an extractive imaginary, and the sea throws up the many ways in which extraction could have been, even if everybody agreed on the idea that the sea is essentially a set of resources. There are multiple models for how to access and use these resources that were thrown up in the lawmaking debates. A key example here is seabed mining. Seabed mining, we know, is an issue that of current immediate concern, as the International Seabed Authority is in the process of finalizing its mining code. In fact, it hopes to adopt the final draft of the exploitation regulations sometime this year. This will pave the way for the current 30-odd exploration licenses to begin commercial recovery of various oceanic resources. You have here on the slide a picture of a whole set of claims that exist just with respect to one zone of the ocean. This is the Clarion-Clipperton zone, and this is the site of nearly 20 mining claims. So you see which are all marked out in different colors. We know that there are huge concerns about the environmental impacts of seabed mining. There are questions about whether there is even a market that can support mining operations across 30 or so sites. We know that this creates a rush amongst most of these license holders to be the first to begin commercial recovery, and that brings in its own train various pressures and corner cuttings that might again lead to devastating environmental impacts for the sea. Also, the directions of the negotiation suggest, if anything, a further retrenchment of the common heritage principle. This is a principle that has mutated and transformed in time. It changed from the idea of equitable participation in seabed mining, as well as equitable distribution of its resources, to an idea of just the distribution of some of the profit, to ideas that are now attenuating how much profit there might be to distribute as well. It's an idea that has in other ways mutated in many ways in the direction of commercial interest, and there is happy to talk about why I say this in the Q&A, if that is helpful. Against this, the 1960s and 70s offered up many other visions of seabed mining. One example is the suggestion that a number of countries had made and had been able to push for a while of seabed mining as a monopoly operation. So not denying the action of seabed mining at all, not suggesting that seabed should not be mined at all, or that there should be a ban, saying yes, mining could continue, but in a very different form from how it is imagined today, a monopoly operation conducted by an international organ called the Enterprise, which, much like its sci-fi counterpart, would essentially be something that would conduct its operations on behalf of humanity as a whole. The interesting thing about this was not just that it was the kinds of the worlds that lay buried within this idea of a monopoly operation. The idea would then be that instead of 30 or so mining sites as we have at present, you would have one single mining site, which would be essentially a mining site that would be accessed under an international framework and by an international institution rather than a variety of mining corporations. Let's think about what possibilities of making value, of ascribing value to seabed resources, what possibilities of distribution, and indeed what possibilities for environmentalism lie buried within that one idea. One mining site as opposed to 30 is, I need not tell you, one incision on the seabed as opposed to 30 different incisions, but also as an international operation that is not commercial in its orientation, but really about supply security. This is an operation that could very well come to a different calculation of the market value of seabed resources than the commercial operations do. So there were alternatives that existed, that subsisted for a while in the context of, making the law of the sea about how to think about the ocean's resources. Even as resources, they could take different forms and have different values ascribed to them. And indeed, this is sort of where I would like to sum up. In the shape that the law gave to the ocean and the sites that the ocean furnished for lawmaking, we might find the entry points into various imagined, contested, part realized, and abandoned worlds of decolonization and international law that seem to disappear retrospectively under the weight of imagined agreement. The law of the sea reveals decolonization as something, as a moment much richer in its political possibilities, in its economic possibilities, and indeed in its epistemic possibilities than simply a North-South contestation. The worlds that it reveals might have advice for us today, or even pathways to alternative futures as we face the ocean's present, which we know is currently very perilously balanced, on the one hand between visions of blue growth and injunctions not to undermine the law which seems to have been agreed, and on the other hand between fervent advocacy of new blue paths that try to see the world differently. We are in this tense moment where on the one hand, it's the group that is trying to pull the law of the sea into new directions, into unmaking some of what had been agreed in terms of the policies for seabed mining and so forth. And on the other hand, we have this sort of the imagined history of a North-South contestation that was smoothed over by the agreements that were reached in the 1980s and 90s, and which now brook no reconsideration. Against this, I would suggest returning to decolonization, thinking about the alternative possibilities that had existed in the course that had arisen in the course of thinking about what should be done with the law, what should be done with the sea. These are possibilities we could learn from and revive today as a way of finding a way between these sort of these two polar opposites, one which would keep the world as it is, and one which would try to reimagine it completely anew. I would suggest we turn to history and look at the ways in which it has been imagined before, because there's a lot there that has not been so far looked at. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Surabhi.